Good evening, gentlemen. Welcome to Freedom Forum of Orange County, March 1st, 2017. Tonight, we have the honor of having Dennis Gray with us to speak and on about the housing problems we've been having and how you can legally fight and potentially win your cases. There have been some really good successes with this program that he will be presenting tonight. And at this time, without any further ado, let's welcome Dennis.
Okay, everybody. I know I'm kind of preaching to the choir. Most of everybody in here knows what's going on with the country's financing thing. So I'm going to move this chair over here. Just going to give you a primer on what happens with the banking industry. Basically, this is a house, or let's just go this way. This is a new development coming on, and phase one, phase two, and phase three. Phase one, they start selling the houses for $500K, and everybody comes in and buys them. The bank takes the note, monetizes it, and we'll get into what monetizing is, and I think everybody knows that, and then securitizes it many, many, many times, okay? So what they do here is get this cash out of the people from here, and as soon as the bank has monetized it and started securitizing, they turn it over to the NMSA, or National Mortgage Servicing Association. So you get a servicer servicing your loan, and they're collecting your funds, and what they're doing is they keep a piece, they give the bank a piece, and they give all these people that have securitized their interest on it every year. Where do you think the people who bought those securities are getting the interest from? From you, from your payments, okay? And now, what these guys are doing, this is the servicer, they're just sitting back and waiting. Now, what happens is phase one is complete and phase two comes out, and let's just say it's 750,000. Now, everybody gets excited and goes and does a refi. Yeah. Okay, when this is sold out, everybody goes to 1 million, and now everybody gets refi. The servicing association is waiting for one of three things to happen in any one of these phases, okay? One is you sell your home. Two, you refi. Why would you refi? You want to get cash out, right? And three, you get foreclosed. That's what they're waiting for. They're waiting like vultures sitting there waiting for one of these three things to happen. The bank is out of the picture. Why did they want this to happen? When any one of these three things happen, a new bank comes in and this scam starts all over again. You see how it goes? Over and over and over. It's a scam. Does anybody know what happens? Where's the eraser? What happens if you gave cash to the bank and paid off your loan? What do they have to do with it, with the cash? Huh?
Not much.
They have to crunch it up and put it in bottles and sell it. Because the money is not, they can't use that money. You give them cash for your note, they have to, because remember this, there's a asset, a liability, and net worth for the bank. Every day at 12 o'clock at night, all of their net worths have to be zero, all the way down. So if you go in and put in, let's just say $100 in their assets, they have to have a liability of $100. Why? You can go tomorrow and pull it out, correct? So their net worth is zero. The same thing if you put $100 in and you wanted a debit card, they gave you a debit card for $100, their net worth is zero. You get a credit card for $100, they have to put a liability of $100, whoops, and their net worth is zero again. Same thing when you got your mortgage. Whatever the price is, I'm just going to put $100. They have to have the liability equal, and it's again zero. So if you gave them this $100 in cash, they have to zero it out. They can't have it. That's all in all the books that Mickey has written for as the last 35 years. Okay? And he's not just writing the books. Yeah. Mickey Paoletta, okay? And actually, it's Michael. So let me write his name down here. Michael Paoletta. Mickey Paoletta has been doing this, and you can find Michael Paoletta on YouTube. You'll get a lot of stuff from him on YouTube, okay? Now, Mickey has researched all the books that all the people have written, and what he has finally come up with is this product right here, and it's called the MDS, or Mortgage Defense System. What is it? It's a forensic examination of the documents that the bank puts in. Now, what does the bank do the moment you sign your note and your deed? They cut your signatures and the notary's signatures, all of that, and they save it for when they need to redo or come in and foreclose on you. They come in, they remanufacture those documents. So every document that they bring in is a fraudulent document. And why is that a fraudulent document? They never gave you a loan, did they? The very first thing on your document, on your notes, says for a loan that I have received. You never received a loan. Okay? So all the documents that they have is fraudulent, and they have to be remanufactured. So on your deed of trust, what we sign and give them is this document on the deed. And that in the deed, it states right here, borrower covenants. Now, remember this. The first thing you do is you sign the note. And the moment you sign the note, you're monetized. The money came out of your... The MoneyNet Daily Transaction Report 128 shows that the Fed took the money out of your Social Security number account and paid the other side, and they said that you give them a loan. Then they have you sign the deed, and here's what the borrower covenant states. Borrower covenants that borrower is lawfully seized, and by the way, that's spelled S-E-I-S-E-D, Black's Law Dictionary says S-E-I-S-I-N is a freehold estate, 100% free, completely free. Okay, so borrower is lawfully seized of the estate hereby conveyed. You're conveying this estate to the bank, and you're signing this. You don't even own it yet. You're getting a loan, aren't you? Supposedly. And you're signing a note saying, I'm lawfully seized of this estate that the hereby conveyed, and I have the right to grant and convey this property, and that the property is unencumbered. Come on, folks, what does unencumbered mean? There's no debt against it, right? Okay. Except for encumbrances of record, which are easements and appurtenances, okay? Now, borrower warrants and will defend generally the title to the property against all claims and demands. You're just buying this property. How do you know who had it before you? How can you defend it? If you're signing this saying, I'm going to defend it, then why do I need title insurance? Because I'm signing saying, I'm going to defend it. Right?
Title insurance reimburses you for your loss.
Correct. All right? So Now we come down, and further down you go into the thing, and you will see in your deed, it'll say, in item J, it'll state, applicable law means all controlling applicable law will be federal, state, local rules and laws. They violate their own applicable laws when they bring in those documents. Why? They're copies. They're not originals. Federal, state, and local laws require originals to be brought into court. Remember the saying that my wife Maria beat American Express 2 times in court already. One for $65,000 and once for almost $12,000. Okay? And the first thing she goes into court, she asks the judge, do you abide by the rules of court? And he goes, yeah. Why, yes, we do. Okay, does this court abide by the rules of court? Why, yes, we do. Can I get a copy of the transcript if I'm going to pay for it upon completion of this trial or whatever, session? And the judge goes, as long as you're going to pay for it, great, you can get it. Talk to the person who's the court reporter. Then she stated two things, okay, which I wrote down and gave to her to state. And it says, a factual claim requires the citing of a known duty, the breach of which is the causation of damages. Now, for people who don't understand that, what's a known duty when you're driving a car? It's to be driving carefully, right? And if you breach that known duty, you cause damages. So the factual claim requires the citing of the known duty, the breach of which is the causation of damages, as attested to by at least one competent fact witness. That means the person I ran into, not anybody else. Somebody else can't sue me. It has to be the person I ran into. Okay? That, and under the rules of court, and here you put the rules of court in, whether it's California or federal. Then you say that I can cross-examine this person under oath regarding rules of evidence. And you state the rules of evidence, 901, 902, 903, etc., etc. Okay? Now, what are you telling the judge? The factual claim requires the citing. I need the person who I ran into or I damaged here. And I need originals according to the rules of evidence. That's what it requires. You guys are violating your rules of evidence right up front. Okay? Now, and I say, further, Your Honor, she goes, Trinsey versus Pagliaro, 1964, Supreme Court ruling from Pennsylvania states, and I quote, statements of counsel in argument and in briefs, although enlightening to the court, is not sufficient to grant a dismissal or a summary judgment. End of quote. Your Honor, today what I see here is a special appearance attorney who has no first-hand knowledge of any of the facts. And I object to anything he has to say regarding this case. And I'm ready to proceed. Now, what did I just do to the court? Shut it down big time.
But there's an exception.
What's the exception? Go ahead.
Speak up. Go. Yeah.
Yeah. The exception is that it's an equity court. And in an equity court, the judge has complete authority to enforce the codes, change the codes, suspend the codes, or make up his own rules. His only limitation is that he might be reversed by a higher court, which actually has the same crooks.
But see, when I told him up front, are you going to follow the rules of courts, etc., he knows I'm going to go up to a higher court.
Okay.
All right? And then the paperwork that we put in was strong. We said, okay, credit card? All right, how much do I owe you, $12,000? Well, there's no specificity. You need to say, in that $12,000, I bought a pair of shoes for $52. I bought this. I had, interest. Everything needs to be detailed. Otherwise, it can be thrown out. You need to have specificity in any of the total that they're asking for. You can't just, Then the other thing is, you get an affidavit. American Express, where's their head office? New York. The affidavit comes from a keeper of the records in New York. That's 3,000 miles away. Guess what? Under the rule of court over here, the person who's doing the affidavit must be within 150 miles. I should be able to bring them into court and cross-examine them. So I put that in there. I said, hey, these people are 3,000 miles away. I can't bring them in here to testify that they are the keeper of the records. And then the attorney is, you know, the judge read the attorney all of this stuff, and he said, look, my judgment is for the defendant. Maria looks over, and this guy is already packing his bag and leaving. Okay? She came out of there. I mean, she went in like a little schoolgirl with her knees knocking and everything else because she's 5 foot, 105 pounds, and couldn't figure out what I was telling her to do. But when she went in, based on what Mickey and I taught her, she came out a winner. And boy, was she smiling and telling everybody about it. Especially after she came back and saw the and did the $65,000 one. And that one, they went from one attorney to another attorney that had a huge bunch of attorneys, right? And we did a counterclaim against them. And she goes into court, and the judge goes, hey, the attorneys for the other side are on the phone. And she goes, so what does that mean? She goes, well, they want to know if you will dismiss your claim, they will dismiss theirs. She goes, sure, I will. With prejudice, correct. And that's what she said, with prejudice, okay? And they dismissed their claim. I haven't heard from them ever since. It's been 5 years. Okay, they can't. They can't come back against what we just put in front of them. So Mickey is put together, and then, okay, here's another thing in your deed of trust. It says here, mortgage insurance means insurance protecting the lender against the non-payment of or of default. So what happened when they came in? Did they have insurance? So get this. Number one, they monetized the note, which means they took your Social Security number, got the money from the feds, put it into the other bank. The other bank gave it to the title company. The title company wrote a check to the other side and said, we gave you a loan. Now you got to pay us back because you signed this other document saying that you're going to pay us. But then you got insurance. If you don't make a payment, who got that money? And how many times did they securitize it? I've got proof here that they are securitizing, you know, just these two notes here, two different notes, four times each. Okay? So once they are securitized, did they get money? That means they sold it to investors. Correct? So they got money there too. Now they're collecting your funds every month from you. Is this the scam that I showed you earlier that keeps going round and round and round? And we're just being shown every day. It's incredible. Now, does anybody know anything about the court reporting investment system? You don't? Let me pop my
Chris system.
Huh?
Chris system.
It's Chris. Yeah. Have you heard about the Chris system?
Yeah.
Have
I
you seen?
A couple attorneys if they were dealing with my cases if they were investing in the Chris system.
And what did they say?
Oh no, I really don't know anything about that. I think my wife thinks something like that, but I don't know.
Oh yeah, they don't know anything about that. But let me show you what it is, okay? The Chris system. That is Every federal case, no matter how many times you take it back and put it in, every time because you signed your name to the bottom of that, they can monetize it. Okay? So they take that and they monetize it over and over and over. And you're talking about millions of dollars. I've got one in here on my phone I can show you guys. 144 $1 million in 4 days that they then invest in Treasury.
Is the high school, is it CRIS, C-H-R-I-S?
No, C-R-I-S.
C-R-I-S.
And you know what? I will since I don't have everybody's emails, I'll email it to, I don't know, who's the best email person, because this guy seems to have a lot of problem emailing. Who should I get it to? If I can get everybody's emails, I'll be happy to email it to you guys. Jim, I'll send it to you, Jim. Okay? And you can send it to everybody.
I don't have everybody else's address.
Well, get their emails, and then I'll send it to you, the CRIS system. And then I'm also going to email this, okay? The mortgage defense system, this stuff. This is the information about what Mickey needs. He needs every document that you got from the bank or the other side saying that we own your home, like the note, the deed, the assignment, all of that. And then we run it through our machine, the EXIF machine, and that takes your note like this and comes up, it blows it up like 1,000 times and comes up with a sheet like this. It's got all these pink lines all around it. See that? Okay? This pink lines mean that somebody sat at a computer and used their mouse to cut and paste. Those pink lines are embedded in that sheet forever, no matter how many copies you make. Right? So we take all the documents and we prove that there's been fraud put together. That then becomes your exhibit for extrinsic fraud, and that's a 60 federal case, 60BD 1 and 3. 3 is the extrinsic fraud. D, 3. Okay? So now anybody who's lost a home anytime can go for a 60B, D, 3.
What's the number
again? D, 3. 60, 60. 60
of what?
Federal rules.
Is that PT or just D? Go to civil procedure?
Uh-huh. 60, okay. 60 D. Yeah, just go and put 60B, federal statute, you know, and bang.
The rules of civil procedure.
Right. And you'll get, and D3 is the one that talks about extrinsic fraud. What is extrinsic fraud? Extrinsic fraud means they hid the fraud from you. Okay? They hid it from you, and you didn't know that. Now, who committed the fraud? Obviously, the bank and the attorneys, didn't they? So who all is involved in it? The bank, the attorneys, the real estate agent, the guy who's trying to take your house and resell it. All of those people are involved. The servicing agent, they're all involved. And Mickey names all of them in your lawsuit for you.
You can name all of them.
You name all of them because they're all involved in it. And you're going in for fraud on the court. Okay? So there's been fraud on the court for it. So you're telling the court, these people defrauded not only me, they defrauded you. So everybody is getting hung out to dry. So he does this and writes a, I don't know, 60, 70 page lawsuit for you for $1,500. Okay? I couldn't believe the price because I think that's extremely reasonable for the time and effort it takes. It takes about a week for them to get this thing done. And for him to do that, you know what it takes to write a 15, 60 page lawsuit. And although most of it is, you know, copy and paste, but then he's got to add your specific information in here. and put the two together. And then you just go file it in federal court. Right now he's running 19-1, and the one that he didn't lose it, it was a guy who decided to quit because his church members told him, oh, it's not right of you to go against the mortgage. So he quit. You borrowed the money, you ought to pay it back. Okay? But I have a gentleman, and Bob was at a meeting with all of us there. Remember the guy, Gene, who was asking all those tough questions? Bob?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You remember Gene? He was asking a lot of tough questions?
Right.
He's a gentleman that owned 7 banks. He used to own 7 banks. He's now lost, I don't know how many properties, 6 properties. Well, he had an attorney, and he told Mickey, I'm going to court next week. I'll let you know what happens, because he was very confident that he was going to win. Well, guess what? He called the week after, and he said, they're evicting me. Can you help me? Okay. Mickey said, get me the documents. Send me the paperwork over. So what he wants you to do is to follow this, and he's got every document that he needs back here. He wants to know what court, what judge, what sheriff's name. Everybody's name is going to be in there. Okay? And then he'll tell you, I'm going to file this against all of these people. I will email this to Jim, and he'll get it out to everybody.
Is he gearing it for state or federal court?
Federal.
Federal?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What's the success ratio so far?
So far, he's running 100%. When we put this into... When I say 100%, it stops. Everything stops. I have a gentleman, he met him over there, Tom. He filed 17 bankruptcies under different people. He would go in and file the bankruptcy under a different name. So when he went in on the 17th one, he got a notice from the court saying, if we see you in here one more time, we're throwing you in jail. So he called me, and this was just about a year ago, a little over a year ago. And eventually, Mickey did his paperwork. He went through a couple of rounds with the bank, and the last thing he got 11 months ago was, what can we do to settle this? Okay? And he never replied to it, and they have not come back to him and said, hey, what do you want to do? 11 months.
So he's Rick. 19-1. Are those 19 victories...
Victories meaning we haven't won them completely, but we've stopped, and the people are still in their homes. Okay? Now, we do have...
But those are houses, 19 victories on houses.
Correct. Right. We have over 750 on credit card. Okay? He's getting back into credit card big time right now. He hasn't given me a price on credit card, but, you know, the thing is that the way he's going, those 19, he's got one from NationStar for 675 back east. He got a judgment against NationStar. Now, what's coming down the pike is a lot of really heavy-duty ones. Did you hear about the one over here that for $5.2 million, but it's being appealed? Yeah. Okay? They're using similar documentation as to what Mickey is doing. Okay? Coming in and showing the extrinsic fraud. That's what's killing them.
Did you do this stuff on car auto financing?
We're trying one on an auto financing one. What you need to do on auto financing is ask the finance company for a copy of the contract you signed. Because you can't take the one that you have. That's an original. We want to see what they're going to send you back. Okay? Because they, chances are they've cut and pasted. Now, how many people know?
What about tax liens?
Tax liens?
IRS or federal or state tax liens?
Well, we're not messing with tax liens because that's a whole different venue, right? But just like the mortgages, what happens on credit cards? Here's a white paper on credit card securitization. Okay? There's a whole book written, an overview of credit card asset-backed securities. Okay? Now, to show you what credit card asset-backed securities, here's two credit cards for Chase Bank. One is, what's that? First USA credit card and Chase credit card. The total of those two credit cards for the month of November, $67 billion that they securitized. And they're still asking you for payments. Okay, so what Mickey is asking people is the promissory note, the deed of trust, assignment records, all notarized papers, the complaint filed against you, any answers that you may have filed, list of all pleadings filed. Did you have an attorney, which list of all pleadings, you get the court docket or the, what do you call it in Superior Court or something else? Hang on a second. Did you have an attorney at any stage? Did you get a summary judgment? And if so, provide it. Your answer to the summary judgment, any judgments against you regarding the subject property. Date of the filing of the complaint, date of summary judgment was filed. Do you have a judgment against you? And if so, the date issued by what judge and what court? We're ready to start work for you. Yeah, Rick?
Did your wife get a 1099 after she settled? Or did you get 1099?
Nope.
So there's no...
Okay. They cannot go back on that. Okay? There's no what they call forgiveness of the debt, which means that that becomes income for her.
Right. That's all I'm making sure.
No. Right. No. And we got it all completely cleaned off of her credit. You take them to court, okay? It's like we're talking here, you know. You have to take them to court. They want non-judicial estate, so they just want to foreclose on you. Correct. So you need to go in and say, look, this is all fraud. But the way you're foreclosing, you're using fraudulent documentation.
There's a provision where they say that you cannot counterclaim on an unlawful retainer action. However, there's an exception to that. And the exception is that if you have an ownership interest in the property, you can counterclaim, which then forces it into the normal procedures for court proceedings. No, I'm not in that business. But you will find the reference to that at 1215.org. You click on where it says mortgage, and then you'll see on the next page on the right-hand side the reference to it.
Now, we did one of these unlawful detainers for a friend another Filipino lady down in National City, and she had a rental property in Las Vegas. And the renter was being served on the UD papers. So Mickey did the paperwork, and she went and filed it in Superior Court over there in Henderson. The judge refused to do anything. He just sat back and didn't do anything with it. Okay? So Mickey called. He called 3 days in a row, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. He called. I want to speak to the judge. I want to speak to the judge. On Monday, would you believe, the judge called him in Pennsylvania and told him, I can't do anything with you with this suit for Mrs. Cortez. You need to take it up to a higher court. And he said, take it up to District 8, to the district court. So he had to go to federal court and file it. The judge himself told him that. Okay? So, I guess I've pretty much given you all the information that I have on Mickey and what he's doing. He's, like I said, he's ready to, we're ready to start doing things for people on credit cards as well. I have been very successful. I was in the credit industry for a long time, successful in cleaning up people's credit. I have a company, a friend of mine has a company that cleans up people's credit for as little as $316. And so he goes in and starts doing all the challenges for you for a little less $316. So that's a and his the website is simple, very easy, is IC, that's an ICR8. So I create wealth, WEALTH.com. And you sign up over there. You need to say that it was referred by Dennis. And the total cost is $316. And he keeps doing that over and over for you. Okay?
Does it clean the federal tax notice?
He'll do all the stuff. Whatever he can get off for you, he'll work on. I've seen him work on things and get people score in 30 to 60 days, they go up 100 points, you know. I've seen that happen. But it just depends on how bad it is, if you got bankruptcies and how persistent they are in keeping it on. But you need to just keep going at these things. I used to take people and clean up their credit reports. It was just absolutely incredible. I had the largest credit repair organization in 1990 in the state of California with a company called Giving You Credit. And a few of you might remember that. And I wasn't the owner of the company, but my organization was huge. Okay? Because the Fair Credit Reporting Act states that everything must be 100% accurate. Cannot be 99.99%. Must be 100% accurate.
I lost my mobile home. I think it was 2000. A
few years back, yeah.
A few years back. This was shortly after I had lost
Judy. I remember that.
I went to court, and I was told how to prepare it, but I guess my mind was not with it all, and I didn't do what I was suggesting. I was waiting for a master, big court thing. And of course, I listened to everybody else, and I listened to your people, and I said, wow, I really messed up on that one. Now,
you can go back on that one.
That's what I was going to ask, because I wanted to go after both the attorney, the nerve. The attorney,
you're going after
the nerve,
yeah.
The nerve to say that I wasn't married. He had never been to my house. He never met anybody. But he, and I learned from Dennis, not Dennis, but I can't think of his name now. Anyway, that, was he here as an attorney or was he here as a witness? Kind of thing.
Right.
He had used him. I listened to him on one of the sessions he did. But that, I also had paperwork from a gentleman back east who went and checked. 9 times my house had been put on the market.
Multiple listing, yeah.
Yeah. I've got all of those papers, I've got all that stuff. And so the only issue I've got right now going is because the IRS has been after me fraudulently in the sense that they created the paperwork but I refused to file. One was through a sale of apartments that I had managed old partial owner and management way back when, 2003. And so they claim that, because I didn't file, they claim I had it for less than a year, did all kinds of things, creating more, saying I owed more than I had gotten for the property to begin with. This is a thing that I'm concerned about, that if I go after the one, that the IRS could attempt to.
IRS might attempt to grab that money from you.
Yeah.
Now, not unless you probably, I don't know, maybe You didn't put it into an association before you did that, did you? You should have done that.
I had at the time a corporation that I had put in the state of Washington. It was not under my name. It was under that. But and what I had been reading before that is that the IRS was told that before they go to any bank to look at any files, they must have a court order to do it.
They never do anything. Like, they can't even put a lien without having a court order, but they do it.
And the bank was Bank of America, by the way.
The banks and the recorders are in their back pockets.
Yeah. There's something I wanted to mention here, because there was a while back that a lot of two attorneys here in California had filed claims against Bank of America. They had, I don't know, many thousand people that had put money in so that they could get their property, you know, get reimbursed for it. The Attorney General, Kamala Harris at the time, went after them. The problem was, and she should never have done so, because in her running for Attorney General for California, she was funded by Bank of America. And so there was a conflict of interest there, but nobody ever did anything about that.
I remember that she was funded by.
I'm not sure, I can't remember who the two attorneys were. Both of them lost their
bar. Oh, you're talking about Kramer and yeah. The other one was Kramer Caslow, and then the other one was Stein.
Right, we were Kramer and Caslow.
Right. Well, we all
anyway,
were.
And I never went back to collect the $5,000 that they had gotten for that. But it's just to me the fact that these. You cannot trust anyone to do the job that they were intended to do, because they have been bought and paid for, as we most of us know. And so instead of our getting our due, we lost it, and of course at the same time I lost Judy and then this whole thing. But it just points out to me that we've got a major challenge every time we want to do something like this, unless we have programs like that. When Dennis is presented, the other gentleman that was at a meeting that I attended, and Dennis invited me to, he had success. I think he said he had a 40 win and out of
40. Yeah. He's got a lot of very successful, very successful.
So it can be done from what it did. It's just a matter of now. I've been looking at it for myself to see what can I do without getting myself penalized by, first of all, the IRS isn't even legal. When I found that out, I've got paperwork at home showing that they don't belong to their private organization.
How many people know about WeissParis.com?
About who?
WeissParis.com. Okay. Apparently, a lot of people know that. So here it is. The key is jurisdiction, right? So go to weissparis.com. Go to Resource Center. Resource Center, and then go to jurisdiction. Okay? Watch that video. It's half an hour. It's going to tell you, you do not fall in the jurisdiction of the IRS. Like we were just talking earlier about the aliens who come in legally and then they go in and become a citizen of the United States. Well, what did they become a citizen of? They became a citizen of the federal United States that sits in Washington, D.C. And unless you were born in Washington, D.C., or have at least one parent from Washington, D.C., or working for the federal government, you're not, they have no jurisdiction on you. And you're going to get that in that half-hour video. Now,
I would like that because I would like to get this whole thing out.
Correct. That's what I was going to tell you, that, and I didn't want to mention it. Right. So.
What about territories like Hawaii?
No. The things that belong to the United States is Guam, Virgin Islands, not Hawaii.
Puerto Rico.
All right.
Yeah, there is an IRS in Puerto Rico.
That's the main office.
Yeah, that's the only one that has the IRS has or everybody else. They're a private industry. They're working for the United Nations too, by the way.
People don't realize this. You know, you get a letter and it says Department of the Treasury. Whose treasury?
That's true.
You need to ask that. Whose treasury is the, are you the department of? What if I sent you a letter and I said, Department of the Treasury, you owe me $50. It's my treasury. They didn't say Department of the Treasury of the IRS or the Federal United States or the United States. Yeah, they don't say anything. There's a Department of the Treasury. So what do you think? Oh, my goodness. Correct.
The definition of U.S. citizen.
Correct.
Subject to the jurisdiction.
Correct. Vice Paris cannot help you if you signed your 1040 and send it in saying, I certify under penalty of perjury under the laws of the United States. Now, you guys saw, I mean, as much as we probably like what Trump's doing and hope that he will be able to change, what did he take an oath to? I take an oath to uphold the laws of the United States, not of America.
That's how he closed his speech last night. He said United States. I noticed that. Not the United States.
Not of America.
Exactly. He did not use of America.
When he was sworn in, I swear to uphold the laws of the United States.
And the thing that you need to understand is,
okay, most people don't catch these things, you know.
The United States is a private corporation within Washington, D.C. territory.
Yeah, then, and to find that out, you go to Title 28, Section 3002, definitions, and you go to number 15. It says, United States is a federal corporation. Then you can go to the state of Delaware and pull up the document for the
corporation,
and it says United States of America Incorporated. And what type of a corporation? A religious nonprofit corporation.
Yeah, but how do you know that that applies to the United States of America?
It doesn't. That's the problem. The whole thing is that it's an assumption on the part of the American people that is our government, and it isn't.
Where
February 21st, 1871.
Where does the IRS say that the Treasury or whatever, the United States of America is incorporated at? And I have a feeling it's Puerto Rico.
The IRS,
but right. You know, the original IRS was in, the very first IRS was in the Philippines, 1915. Okay?
The reason the jurisdiction is important is because the regulations do not put Americans, Americans are not named in the law. They're only named in the regulations. A regulation cannot supersede a law or statute. A law or statute cannot supersede the Constitution. So the reason it doesn't apply to us is because we're only named in the regulation. We're not named in the law. In and that's why the jurisdiction, that's why you're not
in the jurisdiction. Right. By the way, talking about the CRIS, which is the federal court system, the state court systems, here's one of their cases, and this was only for like $1,160, but it says for deposit to the Bank of New York. Okay? Because you sign that, they get to make money out of it. There it is. It says for deposit only, Bank of New York, and here's the account number underneath. This bank, this court's account number.
Another law that you might be interested in is Title 26, Section 83. Section 83 says all property has a cost. And property, we always think of property as land or your stock. You buy it for $10, you sell it for $15. And the profit is the difference between what you buy and sell. But what they don't tell you is that your labor is your property.
Yeah, so your labor is your property,
so
correct.
So if I contract with Dennis for a piece of work for $10,000 and he pays me $10,000, have I reaped a profit?
No, it was just your labor. No. It was an exchange.
It's an exchange.
Correct.
So you have zero income to report.
Correct.
Now, if Dennis gives me a tip and says, I'm going to give you an extra $5,000, well, that becomes taxable. So just keep that in mind. Title 26, Section 83.
By the way, everybody has heard of having a fishing license, correct? A fishing license to fish.
Yes.
Just look up California Title 1. Section 25. You can fish in any stream or lake and catch any fish, unless the only restriction is that the government tells you if there are some restrictions that you do not. It doesn't say you need a license.
That's actually in the Constitution.
Right.
The California Constitution.
Uh huh. California Constitution, Title 1, Section 25. Just go look at Title 1, Section 25, California Constitution. Okay? But if you go fish and the warden comes up and goes, where's your license? And you go, I don't have one. He's going to write things. But you should have one of these in your pocket when you go. And you just pull it out and say, here. Or you can be like the guy that was fishing and he had a bucket full of fish. And the warden came over and said, where's your license? And he goes, license for what? For catching all that fish. He says, no, I'm not catching any fish here. I bring these fish from my home, from my koi pond. I leave them here. I let them go for a swim. In 5 minutes, they come back. I put them in the bucket and take them back home. And the warden says, let me see that. So they dumps all the fish in the pond and is waiting. 5 minutes goes by, 10 minutes goes by, 15 minutes. And the warden says, when's the fish coming back? He says, what fish?
I'll tell you a true story.
All the evidence is gone.
Back in the 1970s, I read a newspaper article about a kid who caught some fish with his bare hands, okay, in California. And they had published an article about him. And fortunately, we had a sharp warden who was on the ball, and they went out and they confiscated that fish and they prosecuted him for using an unauthorized method of catching the fish.
There's also another law, I understand, for veterans that they can sell, they can stand on a street corner and sell any item they can sell, any kind of a license to sell.
I have never heard of that, but you know, hey. No. Anytime you're doing something without a license, you know, we all know what a license is, right?
Sure.
It's the permission to do what's illegal to do without it. So as long as you have a license, it's legal. If you don't have a license, it's illegal. You can't be a drug seller without a license. So I thank everybody for listening to this process, and if you got anybody who's interested in it, please get in touch with me. Oh, by the way, And let me give you my phone number. Dennis Gray, and my number is 619-571-7011. And my email is tlctrust@gmail.
That stand for Tender Loving Care?
Tender Loving Care.
About what?
About
notaries.
Let me see if I can answer it.
Okay. Well, I have some documents that were notarized that my signature was notarized.
Uh-huh.
Which wasn't my signature, nor had I ever appeared before that notary, nor had I ever been in the state of Florida. Is there some way I can...
You can check, yeah. You can check with the Secretary of State for the Department of Florida and say you want to see the notary's book and page where you put a thumbprint and sign that notary's book and page. See whether that's even a real notary over there.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, but you then you
can then the
right. Then you need to send a copy of that document to the Secretary of State for Florida and ask the copy of the document that you say that has your signature on it, and say, this is fraudulent. I need to see the book and page that...
How does that get me my money?
Well, at least you're going to know that it was fraudulent. Then you'll...
I already know it's fraudulent.
Yeah, but if you get that from the state, you can now go into court and have an action because you got proof.
And since that was fraud, there's no time limit.
No, that's what that extrinsic fraud thing is.
You can take it into federal court for diversity of citizenship basis.
Correct. Federal court.
And you need to show that the injury that occurred to you was here, so that then you can bring him in over here when you sue him.
Yeah, you can bring them over here. Correct. And they may want to settle before they come over here.
Well, I'm thinking the insurance company might want to settle.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. She's got to have omissions and errors and omissions insurance.
They do, but they only have $7,500.
How much was the problem for you?
I'm not exactly sure, but it's got to exceed more than $10,000.
Well, I would.
I don't know how much I lost. All I know is that I found out 5 years after the fact that I wasn't receiving the commissions on the business side.
Hmm.
And then the insurance company wouldn't provide all the documents.
Well, there is a provision, I think it's in the evidence code, that says that whenever the opposition hides evidence or destroys evidence, then whatever your claim is that you're claiming was in that information must be accepted as true.
Oh, good.
Now, there's a case called Racine versus California. Racine was a tobacco company in San Diego. They had a case against California, and they proved that there was fraud in that. And California changed the law to state, if we tell you it's fraud, then it's okay that we're committing fraud. So what did they do with that deed when they told you, you're signing this over? They're showing you that they're fraudulently taking it away from you. Okay, that's called a cognovit note. It's a confession of judgment. And that's also included in Mickey's lawsuit.
But by the way, what was the case? How do you spell it?
Racine. I think it's R-E or R-A-C-I-N-E. Racine versus California.
R-A. Say it again.
R-A-C-I-N-E.
R-A-C-I-N-D?
N-E, E, like Edward.
Like Racine, Wisconsin.
Right, Racine, Wisconsin, yeah. Yeah, I met the gentleman, and he told me, he says, they changed the law to say, if we tell you it's fraud up front, it's okay. We can take your money. Well, anyway, I'd like to thank everybody for listening to me and giving me a little opportunity. I have another meeting down the road over here somewhere. They just texted me and said, let me know as soon as I'm ready.
He has a question over there.
Go ahead.
This is a quick question, not to make it long. I had a lawsuit to the bank here, three times.
They went to the court appeals, and every time I met the last of them, it's missing, okay?
Right, but you were in state court, right?
State court, yeah.
Right.
Then now I went to New York court, and I don't know if it's legal, but I don't know about the system that works in the federal court, either the other one, so. In New York now, they tore my case down to say that my company transferred back to California, the United States District Court. How can that happen?
Where is the property?
In Van Nuys, San Fernando Valley.
So why don't you take it into federal court over here?
Because I got tired of everybody got dismissed my case with the evidence.
Well, you got to take it with the federal court with this evidence. And you need to show them that the documents that they put in are all fraudulent. They're remanufactured. Every document is remanufactured.
Yeah, we discovered that now. Not to offend you, but
so,
I think the place that I don't know if you've heard of, Bill Patalo, one of the guys.
So all those judgments that you have should be set aside because of extrinsic fraud. Okay? I mean, for $1,500, I can't go wrong.
Yeah, well,
I'm doing my own house this way. Okay.
I just got this declaration from another guy. His name is Bill Patalo. He wins a case in Florida. But you know, I'm willing to go forward any way they can help because I had the hard evidence of what they did to me. They switched my bone right in front of my.
Well, all of that stuff is going to be good. But the best part is having proof that the documents that they're submitting to court are fraud.
How far can you go back on property?
You can go back forever because extrinsic fraud, and you go read that, if you read that D3, it says any judgment is void. It doesn't give you a time limit.
So that's what is extrinsic?
Extrinsic. E-X-T-R-E-N-S-I-C. Extrinsic fraud.
Let's say, for example, you purchased a house in 2000, and then you refinanced it in 2004, and then you refinanced it again in 2006. Can you do anything with the 2000 purchase or the 2004, or only the most recent?
No, you're just going to have. You can't do anything because they haven't foreclosed on you. They haven't. They haven't done any damage to you. But now you can go in for damages and get that.
Do you know anybody that's beating property tax issues?
Is what?
Beating property tax.
Sales
of property tax. Property sold for property.
For property taxes? Well, that I don't know. Because that after 5 years, if you haven't paid the tax, they put it up for sale and then people go buy it. And they buy it for peanuts compared to what your property is worth. Well, yeah, they may, but they got it for a good price.
I know that there's a law that says that if a lot of properties around here are on ranchos, and they're on.
Yeah, there's a lot of properties.
Say that they don't have any rights to
it. And they got a new system coming up where they're putting it online, and people can bid for them online and so on.
Already.
Right, right. They just. Had it down in San Diego.
There was a guy that knew how to deal with that. Unfortunately, he passed away a few days ago.
Bob
Schaefer, right.
Oh, yeah, I was working with him.
He actually got it so that the sheriff knew that he could not step foot on the property because it was under land patent.
Well, I was using that, and they just walked over.
Yeah, they don't.
Well, you there. That's where I get it. What I do is that whenever they do something illegal, well, first of all, you have to be the plaintiff, and then you have to be in a court of record, okay? And then you have to know who you are. But then what you do is you sue on that basis, and when they do something, you issue an order removing the judge's order, whatever it may be. And as we did in one case, we had the guy, the judge issued several orders, and we found him in contempt of court several times. We let him build a record of a half dozen so we could show what a jerk he was. And then we issued a bench warrant for the arrest of the judge. And that's what turned him around. All of a sudden, he became one of the nicest judges you ever met. That's what you can't. You have to understand that they will test your knowledge. Okay, they will push you. And if you you respond correctly, then they back down. But this particular judge was a real jerk. I mean, he was totally arrogant. So he had to get the real treatment, you know. But that's
it's interesting because with Bob Schaefer, I tried researching some of his cases. And every time he helped someone, he was listed in there as being a co-plaintiff. Every time he lost, and I looked at it, but he was fined over and over again $25,000 for helping someone when they lost.
He was fined $25,000?
He was fined by the court $25,000 multiple times and told him don't do it again. So I haven't found any wins by him in court yet.
I had a situation in my house before I lost it. When I was doing some remodeling, I had a whole bunch of wood piles and everything, and I had a real old guy next to me who complained about everything, okay? And one day I got a knock on the door, and I had, oh, we're code enforcement. I said, yeah, so what can I do to help you? He says, I want to take a look at your back. I said, I'm sorry. I'm not letting you in my backyard. He went away. A week later, I got issue result.
I'm currently fighting code enforcement in Lakewood. They went after me. We had someone who doesn't even live next door, but his mother does. He didn't like our camper in the driveway. So they started going after us, and I proved to him, I said, look, you can't, your code, municipal code, is superseded by state code. This is a non-op mini RV. I don't care if he doesn't like the looks of it, and if you don't like it either. Your municipal code is preempted by state code.
Correct.
So they stopped that one. So the guy got very frustrated. He started going after everything else. Didn't like our flowers, but we planted better flowers. That's fine. He ended up with nothing left. We went before the building commission, and finally they said, well, they've corrected everything we've talked about. The flowers are corrected, this and that, but there's a little window in the garage door that's the glass is missing from. I said, yeah, that's our pet door for our cat to go in and out of the garage. Oh, and also, their backyard isn't as neat as it could be. You've got two barbecues, why do you need two of them? It's none of your business. Those are objects of art. I have the right to my free expression, which is from Bob Schaefer.
Unbelievable.
And I actually had the city prostitutor, as I call him, speak into the microphone that the First Amendment does not apply here. This is in an oral recording in a building commission meeting where I'm saying that I have the right to free expression. It's an unalienable right protected by the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. And he spoke up and said the First Amendment does not apply here. So then I showed the building commission that there's nothing public. First, there's no hazard anywhere. The guy next that was complained at one point. He got frustrated because they couldn't do anything with me. Finally, he complained there was dog mess in the backyard. We have a big dog, so they called in the local. They called Siaka, the local humane society. They knocked on the door and wandered in the backyard. I said, fine. Took him back there. There's a gate. The dog doesn't go back there. So they went back there. There's no dog mess anywhere. No sign of it ever been there. So they gave me a clean slate. So he had a false report at that point. But anyway, so in the hearing of the building commission, we essentially proved there was no hazard of any kind, and there was nothing public about our backyard or our pet door. So the building commission saw that. So the lawyer, the city attorney, said, well, okay, if it's not public, let's just take the resolution and strike the word public everywhere. We'll just declare that we're going to abate a nuisance. Well, if it's a nuisance and it's not a public nuisance, it's a private nuisance. They have no right to abate whatsoever. So I just finished writing them a letter addressing every single councilman, because it's about to go before the city council now because we appealed it. I'm telling them that, you guys are acting under color of law, without jurisdiction, and you have incompetent attorneys. You need to fire your two attorneys and hire competent counsel. If they can't even look in the municipal law handbook by the League of California Cities that specifically says your police powers only apply if there is a direct hazard there's no hazard and there's not public, then their own municipal handbook tells them they can't do anything. But you've been harassing me all this time. If you don't rescind that resolution that we're a nuisance, meaning a private nuisance, you'll be sued under 42 U.S.C. 1983 for civil rights violations under acting under color of law.
Under color of law.
Jurisdiction. So that's fine.
Well, look, you ran a wonderful defense. Okay?
Yeah.
But my personal opinion is that the best defense is a good
offense.
Okay.
Right. Well, you see,
and they'll
say I have an exhausting administrative remedy.
And you've pinpointed the source as your neighbor, right?
He's not my neighbor.
Well, whoever.
But his mother.
Whatever. The point is, you pinpointed the source.
Oh,
okay?
Yeah.
Why don't you sue him?
Even
if you know you're going to lose, practical side of it is going to cost him to deal with it.
Yep.
Right.
And first, I want to have this administrative remedy with the city, and then I go after him.
No. There are two administrative two administrative procedures.
You see, when the city is probably going to decide that they're wrong and back off.
There are two.
And then I can sue them.
There are two administrative procedures.
Right.
The one you talked about. The other one you've ignored, and that is your own administrative procedure. When you have both running in parallel, once you're aware of this, if either administrative procedure fails, you go straight to court. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, guys. Hang on a minute. Dan had a question.
It has to do with honor and dishonor.
I've been paying a mortgage of a couple of $1,000 a month for 10 years, and the plan is I keep doing it in the foreseeable future. Am I done? Should I use your system? Is there a way for me to save a couple of $100,000 in the long term?
I don't want to recommend anything to you. Okay, I don't want you to screw up anything. It's for the people who have had no choice, but things have happened to them. Okay, then we have a remedy. The remedy is in the law. And as long as you're making the payments, they're happy to take it from you. But you need to know what has happened.
All right, am I done by paying them all that money?
Yeah.
Let me ask a consensus.
I suggest that you continue paying the money and proceed against them. And if it turns out that you win your
you can then continue to make the payments, okay? And ask them for all the documents that we want, okay? Because now they're going to manufacture them and send them to you. Then we take them and run them through this, and for $1,500, you go file a suit saying, hey, you never gave me a loan. You've been extrinsic fraud here. See how that comes out.
Sure.
If you win, you win. If you lose, you still have your home.
And they owe you all that money you paid.
Correct.
We haven't paid our mortgage since 2007.
There's the guy.
They assigned it to Santa Claus.
Exactly, just like, yeah.
They did an assignment from IndyMac Bank to a non-existent entity on this case. After that, they tried to correct it. After IndyMac Bank didn't exist anymore, they did four more assignments from IndyMac Bank. But it was already assigned to Deutsche Bank Trust that didn't exist. They were supposed to do a Deutsche Bank National Trust Company as trustee for the trust. They didn't. They did it to Deutsche Bank Trust that doesn't exist. And Deutsche Bank Trust has never assigned it to anybody else. And then just a year ago, I found that they had two copies of the note with endorsements on different spots of the page. Huh?
Uh-huh.
Oh, one of them is forged, or is both of them?
Both of them are forged.
I'd like to bring out a definition here.
What?
You know, in the evidence code, it says that if a note is lost, that an affidavit saying that the note is lost would be acceptable, and that then a copy of the note could be used. The problem is the definition of the word lost. Now, you think when they say lost, well, it's gone. Nobody knows where it is. That isn't what the word lost means. The word lost means we don't know, we know where it is, but we don't have access to it. Once you understand that, why don't they have access to it? Well, they securitized it.
Securitized, and they can't keep it. They have to destroy it. Why? Because they stamped on it without recourse, paid to the order off, and they deposited into that DDA account. Now, what did they do to your note? They altered it. And because they altered it, it's void. So they have to destroy it.
And okay. One other thing that...
It's altered and void.
As one comment, when I had a manufactured home, which they came and took, I realized that I made a mistake at a time when the sheriff showed up to evict me. I had filed with the sheriff's department and filed the paper with the courts, and I copied the sheriff's department. They never, when they came, and I asked about that, they told me it was not accepted by the sheriff. And what I failed to do was to ask them for a copy of the document before they can even proceed to come in and remove me from the property. But that's another thing too. If you are filing something and they tell you it was rejected, they've got to provide you with a copy of the document showing that that was in fact the truth.
Okay, I'm going to call it a night, and thank you everybody for listening to me, because I got to go down there.
This was a great thing for all of us. I want to thank Dennis for coming and presenting this. I apologize from the standpoint of my emails because of the problems I'm having. We're going to get that rectified. But the fact is that I'm glad that you showed up. Again, if for any reason you're not getting something from me, go to our freedomforumoc.com site, because the flyer will always be on there and the information will be on there.
Freedomforumoc.com.
Right. So that way you'll know that there's a meeting and there is a program and what the program is. Again, I'm changing a different email site, and that's part of the problem. I don't know what's causing it, but we'll figure it out.
Okay.
Thank you again.
Thank you very much, everybody. I'm going to email it to Jim, and Jim's got everybody's email, so he'll send it out to him.